This video will contain spoilers from the world and story of Subnautica. Please beware. Now, the life on planet 4546b in Subnautica can undoubtedly get kinda lonely from time to time, well, at least until you get your cuttlefish. I mean, from the moment your character opens your eyes to the moment that you leave the planet, you are basically by yourself. However, that was not always the case. Right after your lifepod crashed and you basically blacked out, well, there was a period of time where other survivors were actually alive on the planet. And well, those are the people we will be talking about today. I'll be telling you everything we know about the other lifepods that have crashed down, who was inside of them, what their story was, and how they met their eventual unfortunate end. So, with that out of the way, replace your Sea Glide batteries, get ready to explore some lifepods, and let's go! Now, to give this a little bit more structure, we're simply going to be starting with lifepods that we don't know that much about and working our way towards those we know more about. And starting us off in the depths of crag fields is Lifepod 7, which we really don't know that much about. We do know that the unnamed male crew member on it had a broken fabricator, which meant that he couldn't really build anything useful. There is a lot of stuff that can be found lying around the lifepod that was seemingly crafted in his blind attempts to make the device work somehow, but was seemingly unable to. Because of this, we can probably assume that they eventually succumbed to whatever harsh environments there are to be found on the planet, and that's where their story ends. Now, Lifepod 6 had what could perhaps be described as an even more unfortunate situation go on, as it crashed in the grassy plateaus with two female crew members on board. We don't know their names, but we do know that one of them is the head of HR, and the other one is someone who is clearly very important, as the head of HR refers to her as ma'am, but at the same time not someone who's very well acquainted, as the first person has to introduce themselves as the head of HR. Now, this one crashed closer to the Aurora, so they did request help with radiation. However, they met their unfortunate end when the passenger unnamed person lit up their flare, which ignited the fuel line and essentially made the lifepod explode. So hey, if there's leaky fuel, maybe don't ignite flares? Now, the person in Lifepod 4 I'm sure knew this, but they had a whole nother situation to contend with as they crashed in the crash zone and the lifepod toppled over, but not on its own. It toppled over after it was almost swallowed by a Reaper Leviathan, as the single male unnamed crew member reports. Now, his only hope of making it out is to craft a decoy, which he does, but unfortunately, he understands that the distance he needs to cover is larger than the amount of time that the decoy will give him. So he's basically just taking a Hail Mary and hoping it will work out, and well, unfortunately, as it seems, it didn't. Now, that situation was obviously awful, but let's move to someone that didn't have that bad of a situation. Lifepod 3 that crashed into the kelp forest. Now, you would think that this is a place that you can pretty easily maneuver out of, especially if you have something fast. But that was the problem for this two-member crew. The Sea Glide they had was broken, so the only way of fixing it was to repurpose the power cell and hopefully make it run faster, which one of the crew members, the male individual, attempts to do, and the other person, the female, somewhat questions, especially because the likelihood of their plan working out is only like 50-50, according to the engineer. Now, we don't know exactly what happened to them, but presumably that Sea Glide did in fact not work that well, and they were probably eaten by stalkers not far from the exit of their lifepod. Now, talking about eating, let's jump to Lifepod 17 in the grassy plateaus and its single passenger called Ozzy. Now, we don't know too much about Ozzy, but he is thought to have been a chef, considering that he mentions specifically his cafe on board of the Aurora, as well as being very well acquainted with other parts of the ship that he seemingly enjoyed. Now, we have no idea what eventually happened to him, but he does make the note of, quote, weird shadows outside the hatch and weird caves nearby, so it is possible that he either got eaten by one of the sand sharks, or perhaps swam towards the jelly shroom caves and encountered one of the not-so-friendly crab snakes. And talking about mushrooms, let us head to Lifepod 13, the one that crashed in the mushroom forest, this time carrying someone who was supposedly a high-priority passenger, a male called Joki Kassar. Now, we don't exactly know who this person was, perhaps one of the representatives of the Mongolian conglomerate that was supposed to go pick up the Degassi. However, what we do know is that they were heavily praying before impact, and seemingly the systems of their life pod had failed, which caused the eventual collision with the water to kill the person. And talking about unfortunate deaths, Lifepod 12 in the Bulb Zone could probably tell you a little bit about that, as the single medical officer Danby on board appears to be bleeding and infected with Kara shortly after landing. But there is an even bigger problem. You would think that him being a doctor, the bleeding would not be much of an issue. However, unfortunately, during his presumably last moments, he confesses to cheating the medical exams, not knowing basically anything about medicine, and his only qualification being reading medical reports off of computer screens. So I suppose, hey, sometimes it's not the best idea to cheat on your school exams, and what you learn might actually come in useful. This had certainly been the case with Lifepod 19 and the person on board, which would be the second officer named Keen. Now, shortly after detaching and before landing in the deep sparse reef, Keen can be heard communicating with the captain on board of the Aurora, pressing them to evacuate and then receiving orders from the captain telling him that he should try to regroup the entire rest of the surviving crew on a nearby landmass, which I would presume to be the floating island. Now, after crash landing, it's not exactly clear why, but Keen is forced to evacuate his life pod, which he does just after sending a distress signal to everyone else in their life pods, telling them to regroup while on the floating island. Now, you would think that there's no way he would have made it over there, but as we're about to learn from the story of the last life pod, he actually did. And that brings us to Life Pod 2 finally. One that crashed in the Blood Kelp Zone, definitely an unfortunate spot, with its two crew members, the CTO called Yu and someone called Berkeley. Now, Yu definitely seems to know what she's doing, as immediately after the life pod starts flooding, she manages to reconfigure some of the systems to stop this from happening. However, now they're facing another problem. They only have 30 minutes of oxygen left, and they somehow have to make their way up. So Yu recommends crafting whatever equipment they can, and then trying to rendezvous with Keen on the floating island. Now, it is not exactly clear who Berkeley is. It does appear to be the case that Yu was his boss. However, that could probably mean a wide range of different occupations, and without further information, we cannot exactly determine what he did. Now, once again, even though it is unlikely, Yu actually manages to make it over to the floating island and rendezvous with Keen. What exactly happens to Berkeley during that escape is not known. However, afterwards, Yu seems to be very set on trying to help the other survivors, something that Keen does not exactly agree with, but eventually reluctantly follows her. It's not exactly clear what happens here, but around 2 hours after leaving the floating island, Keen makes one final report to his PDA, saying that, quote, he and Yu had been lost to the sea, and well, presumably he did not live much longer after that. So hey, the next time you wake up after your crash with the life pod on the planet 4546b and you start to wonder why you're so lonely, well, remember that to these people, even having other survivors around was not exactly a lot of help. So hey, it could always be a lot worse. But with that, I hope you guys enjoyed the video and learned at least something new from the wonderful world of Subnautica. If you like this video, maybe consider leaving a like, commenting, or subscribing. All of those would be very much appreciated. And if there's anything that I missed, or perhaps a theory of your own that you would like to cover, make sure to leave those down in the comments as well. I would very much like to read them. Now with that, I'm gonna wish you all a beautiful rest of the day, and I'll see you in whatever next video I make. Bye bye.